First of all, let me thank you, the organizers, for this wonderful meeting, and especially Indrani for invitation. I'm not talking about Higgs bundle in this talk, but I'm talking about the fundamental group scheme, which is an object which was born in India. So I'm happy. I'm always happy to talk about this in India. And I decided, since I think there are not many experts in this field in this room, I decided to first give an historical overview and then to define the basic objects. I'm sorry for those who know this by heart. Hopefully, there will be time for new ideas at the end. So, as I promised, let me start with the basic definitions and the historical overview. Okay. So, let's start with a definition that everybody knows, but I write it anyway. So, we start with a scheme, which will be our base scheme. Take your favorite base scheme, like it can be the spectrum of a field, and it will be the case for a long part of the talk. Then we take an affine and faithfully flat morphism of S schemes. I will give examples of everything, so don't worry if the beginning is a bit boring. So, it's a morphism of schemes, and we take G and S group scheme that we require to be affine and flat. If you don't like group schemes, just think to a group for the moment. It can be okay. Then we need an action of G on Y, such that the following natural morphism is commutative. Let me call sigma the action. So we have sigma to Y, we have F. Here we take the second projection. Well, I'm taking left action, you can take right, we don't care. This diagram is commutative, and everybody understands what I'm going to define. So we take the fiber product and the universal morphism from J cross Y to Y cross Y over X. We call it lambda. So we say that, we are still in the definition, we say that F is a G torsor if lambda is an isomorphism. You certainly know GLN torsors because they are in bijection with vector bundles. We are more interested in finite torsors. What does it mean, finite? Second part of the definition. So this is part one. Let's say I and II. We say that F is a torsor. Let's start with constant, or finite, or quasi-finite, or whatever, if G, our group scheme, is constant, finite, quasi-finite, or whatever. End of the definition. Just for those people who are not used to work with the group scheme, when I say constant group scheme, by this I will mean an abstract finite group. So simply a finite group. So okay, let's now give an example of torsors which will be important for us. And then I will explain why. As an example that everybody knows, probably, if not, so S is our base scheme. We take the spectrum of a field, for example. So K is a field. Take your favorite field. So it's probably C, but it's not my favorite. Take X equal to Y equal to an abelian variety. And then what else? And then consider the multiplication by M map. Where M is inside N. Okay, this has a natural structure of torsor under which group scheme, I tell you immediately. So MX is a finite. Okay, one can prove that this is finite. Care MX torsor. And that's it for our first example. And we will show in a while that for the theory of fundamental group scheme for abelian varieties, those will be very important, almost like the most important. We can always reduce to them. Okay, so what is the situation now? So why do we want to study those torsors? We now analyze the following question, big question. So we want to know if we can build a universal torsor in a sense that we are explaining in a while. A universal G torsor with G is not described for the moment. We will know in a while. Dominating all all the constant, or again finite, or again quasi-finite, and so on, torsors. So what does it mean? Okay, this is X, okay? X is represented by a point, and we have many, let's say, finite torsors, for example. Okay, like these. We call them, I don't know, Y1, Y2. We have many torsors like these, with arrows between them, like these, and so on. We want to know if we can build a torsor which lives over all of them and which is the smallest with this property. Smallest, whatever this can mean. Sorry. The fiber of the torsors. So you mean, for example, the fiber of Y1 over X? If you take, it depends. For us, it will be the group scheme acting on it, because we are taking pointed torsors. So if I take the fiber over spec K as an example, so here you have the pointed fiber. Since we are taking a pointed torsor, so here the section, directional section, becomes a global section on the fiber. So it's exactly the group scheme. It's a trivial torsor, so in particular, it's isomorphic. The fiber of this, it will be the fundamental group scheme. At each step, the fibers will be the group schemes acting on each of them. No. Sorry, here you will have G1. Here you will have G2 as a fiber. And then I'm saying this in a while. And then the fiber of all of these will be the limit of the fibers of all of them. So let's try to give answers to this question. So here we start with the historical overview. So the first answer is for what here I called, in a very non-standard way, constant source, which are et al. Covering. So for in this case, so it's the what I called constant torsors. So meaning, again, that the G acting on the torsors are constant and finite group schemes. Groups. You can think to that as constant finite groups. The answer is yes. We can build this kind of universal torsor, and it's the et al. I cancel for the moment. It's the pi at x, small x bar, universal torsor where pi at x little x bar, meaning a geometric point, I don't want to enter inside these details, is the et al, the well-known et al fundamental. Okay, this is a geometric point. I'm not going to define this into details, but if you are patient enough, I will describe this as a particular case of the fundamental group scheme, which is not historically correct, but for today we assume it's correct. So first answer, and this of course has been done by Grothendieck in SGA1. So then, what happens to, there is a funny sentence written in this book, in his chapter 10. That I'm not going to write, but I will tell you. Well, it's written in French. I translated for you in English. So at some point in the 10th chapter of SGA1, Grothendieck claims that we need, well, he's not entirely satisfied of what he built, because some specialization morphisms don't behave very well. So he says, in order to make those morphisms behave better, we need a true fundamental group which takes into account the local component. What does this mean? It means that here we are only considering a constant finite group scheme, meaning abstract finite groups. We are missing many other torsors, for example, alpha p torsors. So let me give you an example of local finite group scheme. The easiest one. So of course, what he has in mind is the positive characteristic case, because in zero characteristic, all the finite group schemes are constant over an algebraically closed field. Let's now consider the positive characteristic case. Alpha p is simply the spectrum of kx over x to the p. Well, you see, you know what this means. It means that topologically, we only have a single point. But it's a point with some structure. It's a point which is not reduced, a non-smooth point. And it's a group scheme. It has a low. There is a low of group inside this. And in this theory of the total fundamental group, we totally forgot to consider this kind of group actions. So Grothendieck was thinking that it was that we had to build a new object. Nevertheless, he didn't build it. And so we had to wait until the 70s that Madhava built this object in his PhD thesis. So this will be the subject of our second section. We are in the answer B to the question, which is concerning finite torsors. Now it's okay. So let's consider the following situation. Okay, first of all, so what Nori does, and I'm going to explain, is to build this object, and he does it in two different ways. I will describe all of them, but again, not in chronological order, but in an order that is logic concerning, logic following this question. So I start with the second chronologically. Anyway, I start. So S, our base scheme, is again the spectrum of a field. So it's spec K, where K is a field, any field. So you can still use your favorite field if you want. But in characteristic zero, you won't obtain anything new, because everything has been described, will be described anyway by this object. Then we we take X, a reduced and connected scheme. Let's say of finite type over K, of finite type over S. Since I defined S, let's use S. And then we fix a point, a K rational point. So what Nori proves, so this theorem appears in his PhD thesis in 1982. What he proves is that I first write the theorem, then I will explain it. The category of finite, so that's what we are talking about, finite pointed torsors over X is co-filtered. Okay, I'm not going to define. I'm not going to recall you what a co-filter means for a category. We don't really need it today. It's a quite simple definition, but it can require some time that I don't want to spend on this. Anyway, we will focus on the consequences of this theorem, which is more important for us. Anyway, what does this mean? What are the objects, first of all? Okay, I erase everything, so then it will be easier to write. So we have X, and here we have many YI, so I is a class of indexes. So what does it mean that a torsor is pointed? It means that we have little yi k rational point, which is sent by the structural morphism to little x, which is our fixed rational point. OK, we have these objects. That means we have yi, gi, and yi. It's a triple, somehow. And Nori proved that all those objects form a cofilter category. What does it mean? So, consequence. That means that we can build a limit, a projective limit. So this forms a projective system, and we can build a projective the projective limit of all these objects. So it's exactly the little pyramid that we had before in the picture. And we call this y hat g hat and little y hat. So definition, g hat, we denote it by pi x little x, and y hat, and it, well, it's the main object of this talk, so let me define it, is the fundamental group scheme, is the fundamental group scheme. Group scheme. And y hat is the universal pi x x torsor. Okay, so this is the main definition. Soon, as promised, I'm going to give the second description that you will probably prefer, because it's concerning vector bundles that are extremely useful and extremely important for this theory. First, let me give you some remarks and some examples about this object. First remark, since we talk about the Dietal fundamental group, so what is the link between those two objects? So if K is algebraically closed, which is often the case in many applications, then, okay, the fundamental group scheme is in particular a scheme, so you can consider its rational point, and this is exactly pi at Dietal fundamental group scheme defined by Grothendieck. Why? Because whenever you take k rational points, you simply kill all the local components. You can do it here, take the points over a field. You don't have many. This is a remark. Now let me give you some examples of computations of this new object. New is not so new anymore. So yes, let me come back to Jacques' question. So since our objects are pointed in some rational points, whenever you take the fiber over the little point x, then yix still has a rational point here. So yi belongs to this scheme. But a k rational point at this level, it means a global section like this. That means that this is a trivial torsor. In particular, it's isomorphic to gi itself. That means that at the level of the fundamental group scheme, y hat fiber over little x is isomorphic to the fundamental group scheme. Sorry. If I have a Riemann surface. I'm not sure I understood. If you take, we will talk later. Anyway. Sorry. Okay, I promised examples. So since I first introduced the example of abelian varieties, let me first give you an example, the example of the computation for abelian varieties. So you remember that I defined the multiplication by M torsor. So as I told you, those are the most important torsors, not the only ones, but the most important. Why? Because Nori proved in 86, if I'm not wrong, that the fundamental group scheme of an abelian variety in the origin is isomorphic to the limit of all these kernel that I defined before, where I recall it anyway, mx is the multiplication by m morphism. That means that any other pointed torsor is dominated by some multiplication by m. So this is the first example. Second example, it's n, for example, this is trivial. And again, we find this in Nori's PhD thesis. Then, just to, I won't talk about this, so I only give the result with no details. So if x is normal, projective, rationally chain connected variety, then the fundamental group scheme is finite. I tell you what is this kind of variety. Anyway, to be finite is really, to prove that it's finite is really strong, because this object is pro-finite in general, is something extremely big. So whenever we have some result like this, trivial or finite, that means that we could cut a lot, which is not the case in general. Just, I'm not giving you any detail about this. It won't be the subject of the talk, but since I introduced these varieties, let me quickly describe what is rationally chain-connected varieties. Only, I will do it only with a little picture. So what does it mean to be rationally chain-connected? It means that for any two point, we can find a sequence of projective line connecting any two point of our variety. Very, very, very roughly speaking. So rationally chain connected. Okay, this is just to give some examples. In general, it's very difficult to compute this object. And in many cases, we don't even know if it exists or not. So as promised, I think it's trivial over C. I think over C, it's trivial. But yes, in positive characteristic, we have examples where it's not. So it's sharp. Yes, it's not my favorite field, but yes, it's important to have it in mind, because we used to take inspiration from the zero characteristic case. Okay, I promised a second a description of this object, and that's what I'm going to do now. So I'm sure that many of the people in this room are going to prefer this description. I also like it very much, and sometimes it can be more useful for many applications. So let's now restrict to K perfect. Again, any field with only this restriction, which is maybe not necessary, but let's keep it. Then we take X over K, reduced, proper, and connected. Well, if you remember, in the first definition, we didn't need X to be proper. For example, the affine line could be good. So we can build the fundamental group scheme for the affine line, but not with this second description. So definition, it's here. One. Definition one, we take a vector bundle over X, and we say that V is finite. There are too many finite in this story. So sometimes it's called Weyl finite because it has been defined by André Weyl. If there exist two polynomials with non-negative integral integers, coefficients, such that then we ask them to be different, of course, such that V is isomorphic to QV, where, of course, the sum is the direct sum, and the product is the tensor product. As an example, I'm writing very quickly. Once you have a G torsor, a finite G torsor, exercise F star O Y is finite. So I mean, there are many. It's not an empty definition, and actually, as you can see from the previous section, it's really related to what we just did. But finite vector bundles are not sufficient for us. We need more than that. We need essentially finite vector bundles. In characteristic zero, they are sufficient. They form a good category, as I will say in a while, but not in positive characteristic. We need more. So Nori defined essentially finite vector bundles. His definition, you can find it on his papers, but it's not the definition that I'm giving here. I'm giving you a shorter one. So I like not to respect historical points, chronological point of view. So we say that V is essentially finite. Essentially finite if there exist F1 and F2 vector bundle which are finite, and a morphism from F1 to F2, such that V is isomorphic to the kernel of phi, or phi, if you prefer. Okay, so this definition is due to Nori, as I said, in 76. So it's the first part of his PhD thesis, which appeared long before his PhD, his full PhD thesis. But the version that I gave you here is due to Born. We have a member of his family here, and Vistoli. In, I would say, 2012. You will tell him that I'm talking about him. The original definition, I'm not writing the details because it's long, but it's very nice, concerning semi-stability of vector bundles. So what Nori did, I tell you in a few words. First, he considers the category of finite vector bundles. Then he considers the category of those which are now known as Nori semi-stable vector bundles, meaning those vector bundles which become semi-stable when restricted to any curve. He proves that finite vector bundles are actually Nori semi-stable. He takes the category generated, the abelian tensor category generated by finite vector bundles, and I prove that it's the good one, like I'm saying now. Anyway, we don't need all those details now because I gave you this definition, which is much shorter. So we have essential finite vector bundles. So a theorem. This theorem is due to Nori, 76. Essentially, finite vector bundles form a Tanakian category. Again, many of you know what Tanakian category is. If you don't know, you won't need it for the rest of the talk, because I will tell you what this implies, cheating a little bit. That means that it's let me write like this. That means that it is equivalent to the category of a representation of some group scheme. And, well, I'm making it short. This group scheme is exactly the group scheme that we defined in the previous section. So this is what gives the second, first chronologically, description of the fundamental group scheme. So we have a category of vector bundles. It's Tanakian. It's equivalent to the category of representation of some group scheme. And this group scheme is actually the group scheme that describes all the torsors, all the finite torsors like we have seen before. OK, now I'm sorry to disappoint many of you. We need to, now you can't take your favorite field anymore, because we won't work over a field anymore. So it's now section 3, if I'm not wrong. Section 3. So OK, from now on, S will be a Dedekind scheme. Dedekind scheme. What is a Dedekind scheme? I'm not giving the definition, but it's a one-dimensional, zero or one-dimensional scheme, regular and noetherian. In general, the most interesting cases are, let's say, S equal the spectrum of a discrete valuation ring. Then, for example, it can be spectrum of the integers and many other examples. Okay. Then we take. Okay. I start with. There is a point C at some point. Okay. No. We are still in the answer B of the question, because we are still talking about finite group schemes. So we are still in B. Okay, anyway, we have a theorem, which is due to Gasbarri. Well, Gasbarri on a paper that appeared in Duke in 2003. Okay, he first proved this result, where he said that when x is integral, then faithfully flat and of finite type over S, faithfully flat and finite type. Type over S, then again the category of finite pointed, it's exactly like in the field case, pointed torsors is co-filtered. Is co-filtered. What does it mean? What does it mean? Again, it means, I'm not rewriting the notation of before, it means that we can build a limit of all our objects, of all our finite pointed torsors like before, okay, that we call like before y hat g hat little y hat. And the new definition that you can imagine is that pi x little x that we define as our g hat, which is the limit of all the gi, is the fundamental group scheme. Is the fundamental group scheme. So this is the generalization for finite torsors over a Dedekind scheme problem. G long tongue in, let's say, 2013. He provided a counterexample to this theorem. So, counter let's call it, let's say, to the claim that I will notice as I will denote as star. Counter example. Star is false when x over spec k s is not reduced for some closed point of S. So what does it mean? It means that unfortunately the proof is not correct. So we checked the proof and it was not correct. Actually, we had doubts since the, let's say, 2010. Then actually we found this counterexample. So we had to work on it again. And we really had to do it because many of my papers are based on this result. So, well, I'm laughing, so there is an happy ending. Well, so, fortunately, so we worked on it, and so M. Salem, Gasbari, and myself in, let's say, 2015, well, we proved that star that we have deleted, that star is true. That means the category of, well, we have a fundamental group scheme, which is the most important. Star is true. Well, I don't know if you notice the poetry hidden inside this. We like to write like this. So star is true. When either XS is reduced for every S point of big S, or so you see that the counterexample is not inside. Or X is normal. So in these two cases, which are largely sufficient for many applications, we have a fundamental group scheme. Okay, 6 minutes left. So I have enough time. Sorry. Okay. Okay, the counterexample. The counterexample actually is proving that the counterexample is a counterexample to the proof in some sense. Well, we know that the method used doesn't work in that case, so we don't know. But we don't know if we can build or not a fundamental group scheme in that case. This is unknown yet. No, exactly. No, the counterexample actually, okay, is a little bit more complicated. The entire theorem is relying on some very important lemma. The counterexample is a counterexample on that lemma. So that lemma definitely falls down in this case. But it's not known if the category is co-filtered or not, even in that case. So let's say with the assumption of used by the original in the original paper of Gaspari, it's not known. But certainly the proof doesn't work. So I'm pretty sure that what I'm going to describe now won't be loved by many of you. The question that people used to do is, do you really need this once you have this? And the answer is yes, of course. So a theorem, let's say theorem 2. Again, EGA 2015, M. Salem, Gaspari, and myself. We proved that, okay, the category of quasi-finite torsors is co-filtered when x little s, like I defined there, so like if every fiber is normal. But okay, so if you take x smooth, is you have it. So why do we need this? So in particular, we have a new fundamental group scheme that we will call pi qf, which is classifying all the quasi-finite torsors. So why do we need this? So this is answer C to the original question that I gave in the talk. Because over a Dedekind scheme, when it's not a field, we have a lot of quasi-finite group schemes which are not finite. They are the majority. So it's a pity, it's a sin not to consider them. Also because Grothendieck, in SGA1, where Grothendieck claimed that he felt the need of a true fundamental group, then there is a footnote where he say, okay, there is a counterexample given by Artin. Well, even in the case of the existence of this true fundamental group, the specialization morphism will not be very beautiful. I don't know those examples, but I start to understand where we can have a problem. It's not impossible that with these new group schemes, problems will be solved. We don't know yet. Let me explain you briefly. This is much bigger than what we just defined in theorem 1. We have the following situation. So we have pi uf and pi xx. Then we can take the generic fibers. So we are here we are over S, and here we are over the function field of S. We consider the generic fiber, pi x, x eta. We have pi q f x, x eta, and here we have the fundamental group scheme of the generic fiber. So we have arrows like this, arrow like this, arrow like this. All those morphisms are faithfully flat. We would like in Grote and Dick Dream that one of these is an isomorphism. This is certainly not an isomorphism. In many cases, it won't be an isomorphism. What about this? We don't know. We don't know yet, not even in the classical cases. So we are going to study this in the future. And so to define a quasi-finite torsor, we'd better define a quasi-finite group scheme, because then a finite quasi-finite torsor is a torsor under a finite quasi-finite group scheme. I give you an example quickly. So, for example, consider R take a discrete valuation ring, and then you consider the following equation, like pi is a too many pi. Let's say t is a uniformizing element. So you have p minus 1, where p is the characteristic of R, which assumed to be positive equal characteristic. Xp minus x. Okay, it should be this. Okay, if you take, so now we are over a discrete valuation ring, you can take the generic and the special fiber. If you take the generic fiber, you have z mod pz, which is an order p group scheme. If you take the special fiber, that means that you cut t, what remains is rx over x, so it's just one point. So it's p points generically and one point spatially. These group schemes are not finite, because finite groups over flat groups are, the order is preserved. Quasi-finite are allowed to be this kind of groups. And it's flat. I tell you because many people ask me, yeah, but it's certainly not flat. No, it's definitely flat. So quasi-finite torsors are torsors under this kind of group schemes. Then I stop. If you consider, for example, semi-abelian schemes, if I'm not wrong, you will have that the multiplication by M map are quasi-finite torsors and not finite. So out of the proper world, it's very easy to find quasi-finite torsors. So they're very natural. This map, the map going from the fundamental group scheme I'm only considering the generic base change, because the special base change can be really, really hard. Yes, that's what I was about to say. In general, I think it can be much more difficult. Then we have the case of abelian schemes where everything works perfectly. But outside this case, the base change on closed points can be, in my opinion, much more difficult. We don't need, for example, here at least we know that we have surjectivity. On the closed points, we don't know. And, for example, for affine line, it's false. We don't even have a surjectivity. my favorite field. It's the field starting with any. I like when a result starts with any field. Let K be any field.